This presentation is on multiple myeloma. We will aim to learn the definition, demography, etiology and pathogenesis, and finally diagnosis and management of multiple myeloma. Multiple myeloma is a malignancy affecting the terminally differentiated plasma cells. Myeloma is characterized by production of a monoclonal protein called paraprotein. They can be of IgG, IgA, IgM, IgD or IgE subtype or purely light chain myeloma. The incidence of IgG myeloma is the commonest, whereas IgE myeloma is a lot rarer. The cell of origin is thought to be post-germinal center plasma cells. The incidence of a new case of myeloma is roughly 1 to 4 new cases per 100,000 per year. Incidence is higher in Africans compared to Caucasian and commoner in males than females. Asian population is reported to have lower incidence compared to the Western population. Increasing age is related to increasing incidence of myeloma. Some evidence show increased incidence of myeloma after exposure to chemicals like benzene and ionizing radiation. Familial clustering of myeloma patients have also been described. Most cases of myeloma, in fact, start as monoclonal gammopathy of unknown significance, or MGUS as it is popularly known. The incidence of MGUS is about 3-4% in the age group above 50 years. MGUS is thought to progress to smoldering myeloma and finally culminating in multiple myeloma through a process that progressively accumulates more genetic events and also modulated by changes in the bone marrow microenvironment. Most patients of myeloma present with hypercalcemia, renal failure, anemia, or bone pains. The acronym for clinical features is CRAB, and these reflect evidence of end organ damage. Hypercalcemia is due to bone damage. Renal failure is due to renal damage caused by paraprotein, dehydration, and concomitant use of nephrotoxic drugs. Anemia is related to bone marrow infiltration of myeloma, decreased erythropoiesis from renal damage, and also contributed by GI bleed, which may be caused by use of analgesics. And finally, also because of anemia of chronic disease. Bone pain may indicate presence of pathological fractures. These patients may present with infections as they are low in immunity and have low immunoglobulins and sometimes even neutropenia. The diagnostic workup should include a complete blood count, renal function, serum and urine protein electrophoresis, free light chain assay if it is available, skeletal survey, and a bone marrow biopsy. In selected cases, MRI of the spine, a cardiac echo, or a renal biopsy may be required. Multiple myeloma has to be differentiated from other conditions where there may be a paraprotein in the blood, and these include marginal zone lymphoma, amyloidosis, Poehn syndrome, and lymphoplasmacytic lymphoma, to cite the common ones. The first reported staging for myeloma was that proposed by Deary and Salmon. This has been largely replaced by the international staging system for myeloma, which was proposed by International Myeloma Working Group in 2005. ISS, as it is popularly known, has been validated in many studies, and the most attractive aspect is that staging depends on only two variables. Beta 2 microglobulin denotes the tumor load, and albumin is a surrogate marker for the effect of myeloma on the subject. In patients who have a beta 2 microglobulin less than 3.5 mg per liter and albumin more than 3.5 g per deciliter, studies show that they have the most favorable outcome and a reported median survival of 62 months, whereas patients with beta 2 microglobulin more than 5.5 mg per liter, or in other ways with very high tumor load, fall into the third stage in ISS with a reported median survival of 29 months. The potential pitfall of ISS staging include false elevation of beta 2 microglobulin in renal failure patients. Prognosis is based on conventional cytogenetics and interface FISH study. By conventional cytogenetics, myeloma falls into two broad categories: hyperdiploid type, which has a favorable prognosis, and this group includes patients with myeloma where cytogenetic study shows numerous trisomies and low prevalence of IGH translocation. The second group is the non-hyperdiploid, which has unfavorable prognosis, and this group encompasses hyperdiploid, pseudodiploid, and near tetraploid multiple myelomas. This group is also highly enriched for the IGH translocation, which are adverse in myeloma. By interface FISH study, presence of translocation 414, translocation 1416, or 17p deletion are unfavorable. Although prognosis is affected significantly by the karyotype and FISH results, treatments at present are not risk adapted. There is an increasing body of evidence that suggests benefits of potential of potent novel agents like proteasome inhibitors and immunomodulatory agents in selected high-risk patients. However, more studies are required. Prognostic factors are dynamic, and new changes may develop when a patient relapses after having achieved remission. It is important, therefore, to assess the patient again with bone marrow biopsy and karyotype and FISH studies at time of relapse. The currently used anti-myeloma agents include novel agents, which are A, immunomodulatory, for example, thalidomide or lenalidomide, or proteasome inhibitors, which include bortezomib, and many others, which are currently in studies. These two agents have changed the way we treat myeloma in the last 5 to 10 years. The conventional agents used in treating myeloma are alkylating agents, which include melphalan and cyclophosphamide, and steroids. Steroids have a unique anti-myeloma effect. Radiotherapy is also a key agent used in certain patients, especially patients who have evidence of cord compression and urgent treatment is required. Radiotherapy may also be used in patients with plasmacytoma, which means an accumulation of plasma cells outside the bone marrow in the soft tissue. At present, the model for myeloma treatment hinges on whether a patient is transplant eligible or transplant ineligible. Transplant eligible patients are generally younger and considered to be less than 60 to 65 years of age, whereas anyone above 65 may be considered transplant ineligible. Transplant eligible patient may start their treatment with combination of two or three agents from the above set list. In most part of the world, patient would get a novel agent, either an immunomodulatory agent or a proteasome inhibitor, or sometimes a combination of these two, with steroid or in combination with conventional agent like an alkylator as the initial treatment. After 3 to 4 cycles of treatment, most patients would have a stem cell harvested. After stem cell harvest, most patients would have more cycles of chemotherapy to increase the response and bring down the load of myeloma. At present, most patients who have stem cell collected would proceed to have an autologous bone marrow transplantation. This involves administration of high-dose melphalan chemotherapy and stem cell rescue following this. A patient may opt to have maintenance treatment with one of the novel agents following completion of the autologous bone marrow transplantation. Some patients may opt to stop treatment after completion of chemotherapy, short of stem cell transplantation. A stem cell transplantation is also an option at time of relapse and could be used at that point. Transplant ineligible patients do not differ in the way they have the disease treated initially. The crucial difference is that transplant ineligible patients are allowed to have melphalan, which is an alkylator, but more importantly, a stem cell toxin. Administration of melphalan would make future stem cell harvest very difficult. After completion of treatment with 2 or 3 agents, which may or may not include melphalan, patients may opt to have maintenance or no maintenance with the novel agent. Most patients at present would relapse after initial response and would need a second line treatment. Myeloma is not curable in most patients except for allogeneic bone marrow transplantation, but very eminently treatable in most patients. Treatment of myeloma also relies heavily on supportive care. Since bone damage is central to myeloma pathology, administration of bisphosphonates for bone protection is very important. Many of the agents used for treatment, especially in combination, increase the risk of blood clot formation, and aspirin has been found to be useful in reducing the incidence of clot. Since most patients have steroids included in their treatment, there is an increase in the incidence of herpes zoster and azathioprine. Administration is recommended. Monitoring blood sugars is also very important, especially in the elderly patients who are diabetic and can be made worse by the concomitant steroids. Adequate hydration would protect the kidneys from effects of myeloma to some extent, and regular physical exercise is very crucial too. Thank you.